In this video, I'll explain how to grant the necessary rules to the FortiGate VM's external connector to manage Azure public IP address assignment. If you haven't watched the first episode, which covers the initial cluster deployment, I highly recommend checking it out. There is a link in the description. Now let's begin by checking the firewall's UI and see how the concepts of interfaces and IP addresses differs from the physical cluster of firewalls. First, I'm going to take note of the IP addresses. Let's check the first firewall. The IP address is 4.225.41.171. Guys, do you think is it correct to put this IP address as our first firewall IP address? If you think so, I should tell you that it's wrong. First, we need to go to the public IP address here and then check all the IP addresses associated with firewalls. We can see FGDP and we can see FGDA and FGDB. Let's see what's FGDP. Can you see it is the same as the firewall number one within the VM list IP address? Then we can conclude that 4.225.41.171 is not exactly the firewall IP address like this IP address. It is not MGMT FGTA public IP address. It is this shared public IP address. I'm going to put it here and make it a bit smaller. Let's make it red. Then let's go and check the other IP addresses. The FGTA, which is literally this IP address. I'm going to put it here, but make it a bit smaller. And note down FGTB IP address. And put it around here. So far so good. Let's try to open the shared IP address using our browser. Good news, we could open the public IP address using shared IP address and see the firewall page. Let's enter the username and password, which we configured when we deployed the firewall using the template. It seems great. There are two firewalls in our active passive cluster, firewall A and firewall B. Let's go to the system and check the HA here. Can you see it shows four ports? One of them is being used as the heartbeat check interface. Let's go to interface and see what's there. In total, we got four interfaces: external one, and internal subnets, and management subnets. Let's find what is the private IP address for these interfaces. I'm going to note down the external private part. Let's go to the networking settings and check the interfaces one by one. The first one, it is firewall A. The IP address is 24. I'm going to write it like that. It is the original design. We didn't follow it, so I should change it here. I put 14 here. And for the second firewall, the first NIC, it is 5. The second network interface card, which should be associated with the internal subnet. Yes, it is. It is 69. I'm under firewall B. I'm going to use another color and write 69. And let's go to the firewall A, the second one, 68. It's okay for our test. Then we know what's there. Before testing the RDP connection and initiating the cluster failover, I want to log in on each firewall. Let's use the public IP address, which we noted down here. Also firewall B. Guys, see, now I'm on firewall A, the primary firewall. Can you see here? It is a bit different from what we had when we make cluster between two physical FortiGate firewalls. The external IP address is 2.4. On the second firewall, FGTB, it is 2.5. The story is same for other interfaces, 69 and 68. I would like to make sure you completely understood it is not like the conventional world of firewall. You are not going to receive two identical firewall when you configure active passive cluster. We also see somehow similar situation when we want to configure destination NAT. In the previous video, I mentioned that in order to keep the video short, I'm going to configure the basic policies in order to make RDP possible. Here you can see one policy that I already created in order to reach from the internet using this IP address, port 3389, and reaching this test virtual machine. Let's check IP address of the virtual machine. IP address for protected subnet is 10.034. And I want to create a DNAT rule using this public IP address and reach the VM in protected subnets. Maybe it is a bit strange why I created two DNAT rules. But the reason is we have two private IP addresses within the external subnet here. And I redirected port 3389 to each one of these private IP addresses. When I initiate failover, the public IP address, which is this IP address, will be mapped from the current primary firewall to the secondary or currently passive firewall. I intentionally use this IP address to show you the function of this public IP address. And also, the main shared IP address on the browser address bar represents our primary firewall. In other words, when I trigger failover, it will be removed from our primary firewall and will be attached to the firewall B, which will be the primary firewall after the failover. Now let's talk about the external connectors. Under Security Fabric, you can find external connector. It is literally responsible for informing Azure and make some basic change like transferring this IP address and removing this shared IP address from previous active firewall and bind it to the current active firewall after the failover. Then it's responsible for failover communication with Azure. Any kind of communication with Azure needs permission. So now we need to make sure the firewalls have all the required roles like readers and network contributors for the sake of implementing the change on Azure. Now, I'm going to bring the resource group that we created, and under access control, need to click on add role assignment and find reader and then assign it to the firewall. In order to assign the roles, firstly, you need to find your virtual machine or your firewall's identifier, unique identifier within Azure. Then you need to click on the firewall, go to setting and then security identity and copy the object string. I'm going to write it down for the second firewall. We need to do the same. Then go to the resource group and find the resource that you created under access control, add role assignment, find reader here, click on that, and enter this string here. We need to do the same for the other role, which is network contributor. You need to do the same for the secondary firewall. I already did that part. Now let's check whether the roles are assigned to the firewalls or not. For contributor, I can see it is assigned to both firewalls, and the reader is also there for both firewalls. Now we finished step 3. It is time to assign the routing table to the right side. Here, open the VNet section and find the VNet that we already created here. Under subnets, you can find protected subnets. Here you need to assign the routing table, which is already created by Fortinet ARM template, to these subnets. And let's go and check this routing table. This routing table says nothing except forwarding quad 0, which is the default route, consists of internet and all the Microsoft related services, redirect all of them to your MVA IP address. Let's find which interface represents this IP address. I can easily find it here on internal. A question for you guys. In the case of any failover, how this IP will be changed within this routing table? Yes, you are true. It is the responsibility of external connector, which we already showed you within the configuration of firewall. Let's check it again. Within the external connector, there is another option for the permission. You can use manage identity, which is exactly the method that we used here. We gave the network contributor a reader permission. You can use client secret and application ID, which is beyond the scope of this video. So far, we finished almost all these steps, and in the next video I'm going to initiate the failover to see how our active passive cluster can cope the situation and how many packets will be lost after the failover.